ladies and gentlemen. I am Captain Eric Spitzer, Commanding Officer of Naval Air Station Kingsville, and it is my distinct pleasure this afternoon to welcome you as we prepare to rename this facility in honor of Commander Everett Alvarez Jr. Please rise for the presentation of our nation's colors and our national anthem. Active duty personnel, please come. Color Guard, present. Colors?
Color Guard, attention. Forward, mark.
Bless each and every person who steps into space. We ask that you guide your steps, and we ask that for your continued blessing and guidance in defending the greatest nation the world has ever known, the United States of America. We now ask for your blessing.
Thank you, Chaplain, for truly an exceptional prayer. Ladies and gentlemen, please stand your seats. Today is an emotional day for many of us here and culminates in a significant planning process that began more than 7 months ago. I am both honored and humbled to be present among so many of Commander Alvarez's contemporaries, men who the Air Boss, Vice Admiral Miller, calls giants on whose shoulders we stand on today. And I'd like to introduce those giants to you now. Gentlemen, as I call your name, please stand to be recognized. Army Master Sergeant David Alwine. Navy Commander Ron Bach. Air Force Colonel John Brodeck. Navy Captain David Carey. Navy Captain Michael Cronin. Army Sergeant First Class Harry Edmuller. Air Force Colonel Henry Fowler. Air Force Lieutenant Colonel Thomas Hanton. Air Force Colonel Tom McNish. Mr. Tam Pham. Navy Captain Joseph Plum. And Navy Captain Frederick Purrington. Gentlemen, your legacy of service, sacrifice, perseverance, and unwavering loyalty is truly inspirational, and we are so honored and grateful able to join us here today. Let's give them all one more big round of applause. We invited more than 500 former Vietnam POWs to be with us today, knowing that because of geography, age, and even weather last night up in Dallas, most would not be able to attend. But we felt it was very important to ensure they received personal invitation. Several of those unable to attend sent messages for Commander Alvarez, and I'd like to share a few of them with you now. From Mr. Bob Randall, NAS Kingsville holds many fond memories, not the least of which deal with the joys and result of many, many war stories associated with flying the venerable F-9 and the camaraderie of my fellow student pilots and the great VT-23 staff in the 1969 time frame. As for Ev Alvarez, he has my undying admiration as a true American hero. I applaud your recognition of him and always wish him the best. Navy Captain Jim Hickerson, Carol and I are honored to be invited and can only say we will be missing being there. Ev Alvarez was a superb naval aviator and an example of patriotism. He was a POW in Vietnam. Our thoughts will be with you for your ceremony. Please give our love to Commander Alvarez's family. Navy Captain Steve Nakagawa, I very much appreciate and value the connection I feel to my dad's service, both as one of Everett's fellow POWs, as well as the fact that Dad got his wings there at NAS Kingsville. Though I'm unable to attend, please give Commander Alvarez my family's greetings, deepest respects, and warmest regards. Air Force Colonel Joe Kittinger, Please give Everett my best regards and congratulations. He richly deserves this recognition. Bobby Gaither, wife of Navy Commander Ralph Gaither. Ralph and I sincerely regret not being able to attend this special ceremony for Ev. We have fond memories of our time in Kingsville after they came home. Tapping code through the walls of our apartments and the dinners at the King Ranch and King's Inn. Those were fun times. And lastly, Vice Admiral Ed Plexton. I truly appreciate your invitation. Ev and I went through Kingsville together in 1961, got our wings on the same day, both joined Air Wing 14 on USS Constellation on its first deployment. Ev in VA-144 and me in VF-143. And we're both on the initial strike into North Vietnam when Ev was shot down. He's had an illustrious career and is most deserving of this recognition. What a great outpouring of respect and admiration, along with many more I was unable to read to you today. Those will be shared with Commander Alvarez and shared on social media. And now, the story of how we came to be assembled here today. It was a fascinating journey that I hope you'll walk with me. Back in April 2017, my public affairs officer was laying out plans for the base's celebration of its 75th anniversary in July, but his efforts to identify a guest of honor who had some history with Kingsville was not going well. It was then that fate smiled upon us. One of our emergency management contacts reported having met a former Navy pilot who had been a POW in Vietnam and earned his wings here in Kingsville. That pilot was Captain Dave Carey. Armed with that information, my PO did a Google search, and lo and behold, he confirmed that Captain Carey not only earned his wings here, but he was a professional motivational speaker. A quick email exchange later, and we have found our guest of honor for our 75th anniversary celebration. And I have to tell you that he delivered a tremendously inspiring speech that left our audience of more than 400 people in awe. Here's where the next story unfolds, and anyone that has heard Dave Carey speak, or who has read his book, will know that this is where he would tell you that this was all part of God's grand design. And I'm not going to dispute that for a moment, because the story didn't end there. See, while doing this background research on Captain Carey, my public affairs officer discovered a POW network site, and after cross-checking a series of resources, he was able to compile a list of more than 30 pilots who had either winged in Kingsville or who had served here. He organized the list by the number of days each had been held captive, and first and foremost on that list was Commander Alvarez. And in the aftermath of the 75th anniversary event, we received so many comments of the power of that moment, it got me thinking that we should name some of our base facilities after people we identified in our research. We developed a list of 8 candidates, including astronaut Lieutenant Commander Richard Jaffe, who perished in the Apollo 1 fire, Captain Michael Smith, who was piloting Challenger when it exploded shortly after takeoff, and Captain Theodore Smyer, a decorated pilot of World War II in Korea, who was dual-headed as commanding officer and the first commander of Training Air Wing 2. All of them were worthy and honorable candidates, but at the end of the day, we kept coming back to Commander Alvarez as our first choice. With Everett's assistance, we compiled the naming request package and sent it off to the Chief of Naval Operations for approval. It was then that we reached out to Dave Carey to ask if he would help us engage the other former Vietnam POWs and to recommend someone who knew Commander Alvarez well and who would introduce him at this ceremony today. And fate smiled again, because as it turns out, Dave was more than happy to help. He even had been the best man at Everett and Tammy's wedding years ago. Search over, circle complete. God works in mysterious ways. Now Dave will tell you that it was all meant to be, that we are exactly where we should be at this moment in time. honoring a legend in the aviation community, we wholeheartedly agree. Ladies and gentlemen, to help us introduce our guest of honor, please welcome Captain David Carey. Thank you very much, Skipper. We are blessed to be here today. Indeed, God does work in mysterious ways. I'm honored to be able to introduce to you Everett Alvarez. Everett and I lived together for 2+ years in Hanoi. He was always the voice of calm and reason and wisdom. And I have counted him among the richest blessings in my life. Plus, whenever I start to feel sorry for myself, I just look at him. And he had already been there for 3+ years and sort of put things in perspective. Ev's bio is absolutely amazing. The things, including the things that he's done since he retired from the Navy. He has numerous honors and achievements. He's had schools named for him. He even had a post office named for him. He served and still serves on many boards of directors and boards of governors. He was the deputy director of the Peace Corps and the deputy director of the Veterans Administration. He has several honorary degrees, which I have assured him he ought not to really put on his real bio, his resume, because they're shaky. In 2016, the United States Hispanic Chamber of Commerce gave Everett the Lifetime Achievement Award, which struck me as a little odd. You see, in Hanoi, Ev was my Spanish teacher. And after we came home and I had occasion to use my Spanish that he taught me, no one understood me. Everett is here today with his wonderful wife, Tammy, and I encourage you all to meet her. It is really my deepest honor and pleasure and privilege to introduce to you one of the finest Americans I've ever known. One of the finest husbands, fathers, naval officers. Indeed, this is one of the finest men I have ever known. And I have the honor of calling him my friend. Please welcome with me Everett Alvarez.
China Sea, and a call for help went out sent by two American destroyers, the USS Maddox and the USS Turner Joy, who were under attack by North Vietnamese torpedo boats in the Gulf of Tonkin. A flight of three A-4s were launched from the Connie's deck that night to assist the destroyers. Two of them had were armed with rockets. The third A-4, flown by the junior officer of that flight, carried flares. That pilot was me, then a lieutenant junior. And as I recall very vividly, the conditions that night were not good, to say the least. They were dark and stormy. Thunder clouds had topped about 35,000 feet, and the ceiling as low as 1,200 feet. And the sea was very chaotic. The destroyers calling out torpedo bearings that they were picking up with their sonars, all the while twisting and turning to avoid being hit. And the aircraft flying overhead in and out of the clouds, trying to spot the destroyers in the darkness in order to help them. And amid that chaos, a call went out. Is anybody carrying flares? So I detached from my flight. I quickly descended through the storm to the base. And there I lit up the sky. Our two destroyers were clearly visible in that lit up area. But because of the stormy sweep of sea swirling around, it was difficult to see if anything else was out there. Some of the aircraft did fire their armament and what they thought were the torpedo boats, but still they were not certain. History has shown that there is still a lot of controversy about what really happened that night. But the event was known as the Tonkin Gulf Incident. And it led Congress 2 days later to pass the Gulf of Tonkin Resolution, which authorized President Lyndon Johnson to send combat troops into South Vietnam, which in turn was at that time the official beginning of our involvement in Vietnam. How were we to know that our actions that night would start a war that lasted till 1973? Our flight was led by a Lieutenant Commander Dick Nicholson, who really wanted to be here today. Nick was prevented because of family illness, but I will note that Nick Nicholson was later the commanding officer of the USS Ranger. And incidentally, it was Nick himself who was ringing for me in the middle of the night in a terminal building at Hickam Air Force Base in Hawaii when the C-141 that brought us home to the States stopped to refuel. That was a tearful reunion 8.5 years later as we hugged and cried. The other pilot in that flight was then Lieutenant Ron Bach, a dear friend who made it and is here with us today with his wife Lois. And again, Ron, let him stand up and let him see you. Thank you. You had a tough time as a baby. As you heard in the introductions, I was shot down the very next day in the rain hindsight, it shouldn't surprise anybody that we ran into heavier flak than we expected. Since President Johnson went on national television in Washington, D.C. here at 11 p.m. and announced to the world that we were striking targets in North Vietnam, but it turns out it was 12 hours difference in, on the ship there. It was a full 3 hours before we had launched from our carrier. So they were ready for us. It was the first raid that we had into North Vietnam, and I was soon the first American into that infamous prison that we dubbed the Hanoi Hilton. 6 months later, I was joined by a second man shot down and taken prisoner. That was Lieutenant Commander Bob Shoemaker, who was then followed by a stream of others over the months and then years. I used to jokingly tell these folks, fellows, that they needed to get there early if they wanted to get a good room. I'm not saying that they like me. That experience doesn't look no game luck by any means. But humor, having a sense of humor, was very important. See, the Vietnamese did not treat us in accordance with the Geneva Agreements on Intrepid Prisoners of War, since they were put not signatories and to the Geneva Agreements. States had not declared war. Therefore, when they're in, we were considered to be criminals, and we were treated as such. Now, the communists saw this, and saw our confinement as the purpose was to get, to have us get rid of our social, antisocial tendencies that criminals were supposed to have.
That is the rules of American behavior that guided
our daily activities. And these were homemade regulations, basically, that were designed to impede the Vietnamese's efforts of extortion. Our senior officers understood well the importance of our physical resistance. And in turn, we all understood what we needed to do. Our heroes in our prisons were not John Banks. They were ordinary guys, as ourselves, who understood that they could be forced to submit to their demands, mainly through propaganda, but through torture. But that was not to be an excuse to use, because we soon learned that compliance extracted by brute force is in no way so damaging to the spirit as compliance that is given away by merely being threatened. John Wayne was noted for saying, "Courage is being scared to death, but saddling up anyway." Our heroes were these ordinary guys that made the prison guards torture them for submission one day, and then make them start all over again the next time, and against the next. We were led by extraordinary men who unselfishly put the best interest of others before themselves. Leaders who would themselves do first what they asked others to do. After the war, there were those who questioned this tactic of forcing the captives to use torture before submitting to their demands. In our case, it was the right tactic, for it enabled us to return home with the important elements of our personal character intact, our self-respect, our integrity, loyalty, our motto was, return and honor. So in the end, about 500 of us came home from the north, from the prison camps, and another 100 from the south. And as you have seen, a number of with us today. And again, I just want to acknowledge the presence of these other fellows, all of them who performed exceptionally. Our legacy is well known. We went through an ordeal that very few have experienced in history. Future aviators that passed through here will be reminded of their story. Gentlemen, naming this facility after me essentially is honoring you and what you have done. Because together we survived that experience. None of us could have done it by ourselves. We were a team. We pulled together. I accepted this honor, but in reality, it is honoring you all. And all of those who have passed and flown west or who could not have made it today, I want to thank you for having me up here today. To the future aviators who passed through the year, those of us today, as you leave here and move on in your careers, equipped with new technology, skills, you may find yourself someday having to saddle up, face new challenges, and hopefully you understand that there are some was expected of you, but more precisely, what in conscience and in duty you expected of yourself. Ladies and gentlemen, this is our story, our legacy. Future aviators, you too will have your story. And I ask you, is there any doubt about the responsibility that you have in providing the moral leadership and the positive role model for those who follow you? Thank you. And God bless you.
Whereas Mr. Everett Alvarez Jr. was born in 1937 in Salinas, California, and is the grandson of immigrants from Mexico. And whereas Alvarez attended Santa Clara University on an academic scholarship, whereas Alvarez joined the United States Navy in 1960 and was selected for pilot training, where he earned his wings from Naval Air Station Kingsville in 1961. As Alvarez's Douglas A4 Skyhawk was shot down in the immediate aftermath of what is known as the Gulf of Tonkin Incident. And whereas Alvarez endured 8 years and 7 months of brutal captivity by the North Vietnamese in the Gulf of has arisen, also sarcastically known as the Hanoi Hilton. And whereas Alvarez was released on February the 12th, 1973, as part of the first group of American POWs, getting pretty upset about this, under Operation Homecoming, under Operation Homecoming, and spending 3,113 days in captivity. Whereas after hospitalization, Alvarez attended refresher flight training with VT-21 at Naval Air Station Kingsville, and then attended the U.S. Navy postgraduate school. Whereas Alvarez retired from the U.S. Navy with the rank of commander in 1980 and later earned a master's degree in operations and research analysis in Jurisdiction. And whereas Alvarez in April 1981 was appointed by U.S. President Ronald Reagan to the post of Deputy Director of the Peace Corps. And whereas in July of 1982, President Ronald Reagan nominated and U.S. Senate confirmed him as the Deputy Administrator of the Veterans Administration. And whereas Mr. Everett Alvarez Jr. is seen and is a true American hero. Now therefore, I, Sam Murphy, again, as Mayor of City of Kingsville, Texas, do hereby proclaim the 14th day of March 2019 as Everett Alvarez Jr. Day in the City of Kingsville for his love and dedication to his country. As witness whereof, I have guaranteed cause the seal of the City of Kingsville to be affixed as the 14th day of March 2019, signed by me and attested by our City Secretary, Mayor Thomas Smith. Happy Everett Alvarez Day. And also as a token of our appreciation and admiration for Commander Alvarez, welcome home. And as a token, I want to give you a key to the city.
Please stand up and remain standing. We'll hold our applause. The research provided by Kevin Clark, and the hard work of other volunteers who were greatly assisted by our friends at Vertex Aerospace. I'd like to personally thank, and as I said, please stand, the following individuals. Mr. Jim Weisinger, Mr. Justin Carabel, Mr. Felix Chavez, Mr. Ernesto Gallegos, Mr. Ernest Garza, Mr. Daniel Gerardo, Mr. Daniel Lay, Mr. Larry Trejo, Mr. Randy West, and Mr. Jeff Zimmerly. These are the men who helped make our recreation of Fallen Eagle come to life. A round of applause, please.